Every time a new skyscraper goes up, we lose another little bit of our history. And often it's not so much the building itself that was interesting, but what happened inside it. This tower of steel and glass is at 105 York Street in Sydney. But 35 years ago, there was a famous restaurant here. It was called Romano's, and it catered for the rich and powerful in this city. One of the men who ate here was the New South Wales Police Commissioner, Bill Mackay. His favourite waiter was a man named Tony, Antonio Agostini to be precise. And in 1944, the policeman and the waiter found themselves as the key figures at the climax of Australia's most mysterious murder case.
You must remember this. A kiss is just a kiss. A sigh is just a sigh. The fundamental things apply as time goes by. It's still the same old story. A fight for love and glory. A case of do or die. The world will always welcome lovers as time goes by.
I happened to be walking along the side of the road, leading a bull, which had been at the Holbrook Show, and leading it along the edge of the Howlong Road, when I came to this culvert. And looking down, I could see this body lying at the entrance to the culvert. It was quite obvious that it was a body. It wasn't visible to anybody travelling in a vehicle, but to me, walking along the shoulder of the road, quite obvious.
It was a fairly gruesome sight, wasn't it?
Oh, yes, yes.
The body that Tom Griffiths found in that culvert 45 years ago was of a young woman, her face mutilated and her body severely burnt. A bag had been drawn over her head and shoulders, and she was loosely clad in pyjamas. It was the beginning of a mystery that would keep the police baffled for a decade, the beginning of the Pyjama Girl murder case.
Can you remember what you said to anyone when you got back?
Well, I was met at the back door of the home by my sister. And before saying anything, she said, what's happened to you? You seen a ghost? And I said, well, something like that.
For all the local police could discover about her, the Pyjama Girl might just as well have been a ghost. In Albury, they organised a detailed examination of the body. There were multiple wounds to the head, severe burning around the trunk and buttocks, and a small bullet wound below the right eye. A local dentist made a cast of the victim's teeth and prepared a chart of all dental work for circulation throughout Australia. Detectives carefully sifted through what remained of the woman's clothing and effects, especially the ornately embroidered pyjamas that had already given the crime its name.
The identification of the body seemed like a mere formality. Just a few more days and then police could get on with the real business of tracking down the killer. But days did pass. And then a reporter noticed that the body, which had been kept on ice, was developing green spots. It was decided to bring the corpse here, to the anatomy mortuary at the Anderson Stewart building in Sydney University. The body would be transferred to a bath of formalin, until further notice, as the officials like to say.
Hundreds of people anxious to help solve the crime have viewed the body, but with no result other than personal horror. For no one who has seen it once wants to see it again. The body of the girl had peculiarities. Large hands, peroxided hair, ears with little or no lobe. It was thought that these peculiarities must establish her identity. But disappointment followed disappointment.
No one then realised what a weird exhibit she would become, or just how long the strange cadaver called the Pyjama Girl would lie in state.
By the end of the 1930s, the Pyjama Girl case had become Australia's greatest murder mystery. The police tried just about everything in their attempts to identify the girl. Yet they could do little better than the rough description they'd first released within hours of finding the body. One of the women on the missing persons list who'd fitted that description was this rather attractive young brunette from Melbourne, Linda Agostini. Her husband, Antonio, became a prime suspect, He was even asked to view the body, but because of a single, apparently insignificant oversight, the police let him go.
The Albury dentist who made the first examination of the teeth made a mistake. He didn't notice two porcelain fillings on two front teeth. These had been so expertly executed that he just didn't notice them. And strangely enough, they didn't show up on x-rays that he took. So he found only six fillings in the teeth of the victim, when in fact there were eight. Mrs. Agostini's dentist had already been to the police, but he'd reported that he'd done eight fillings on Mrs. Agostini, and this for many years threw police off the scent.
Unaware that just two tiny fillings stood between them and a positive identification, the police were forced to broaden their search. They set themselves immense tasks of legwork throughout the eastern states, none of which turned up even one new lead.
Messages, photographs, circulars, letters were sent to all parts of the world. Woman aged 22 to 28 found murdered. Height approximately 5 feet. Body well formed. Peculiar ear formation. Little if any lobe, no roll, bluish eyes, bleached hair. Can you place this woman? Back from the great cities and tiny outposts of the world came the reply. No untraced woman answering to your description is missing from this country. Thus, though all possible avenues were explored, the efforts of the police remained fruitless.
Determined to solve the murder, the New South Wales Police Commissioner, Bill Mackay, adopted a habit of putting a fresh team of detectives on the case every few years. In 1944, 10 years after the body was first discovered, a group of three dentists were asked to make yet another examination of the pyjama girl. They noticed a tiny gap in an upper bicuspid which had not been recorded previously. After all that time and the formalin bath, one of the two porcelain fillings had fallen out. Excited, the dentists quickly discovered the other small filling that had been overlooked in Albury. The dental chart of the pyjama girl now matched that of Linda Agostini in every detail.
Suddenly they came back to the Agostini theory, and then it so happened that Tony Agostini was well known to Mr. Mackay because he was employed at Romano's restaurant where Mr. Mackay habitually took his lunch, and indeed he used to wait on Mr. Mackay. Mackay simply contacted Agostini and asked him to come in and have a talk, and when he came in he confessed to the whole thing.
It was as simple as that after all?
It was as simple as that after all those years.
After the protracted drama of the hunt, the inquest and subsequent trial of Agostini came as something of an anticlimax. The constant blaze of publicity surrounding the case had attracted eccentrics, some of whom disputed the identity of the pyjama girl as established by the police. But the coroner, judge and jury were unmoved. The body in the formalin bath was that of Linda Agostini, and she had been killed by her husband, dumped in the roadside culvert and set alight. No motive was ever established, and surprisingly, Antonio Agostini was only convicted of manslaughter. In 1948, after serving less than 4 years, he was deported to Italy, where he remarried and eventually died in 1969.
There's no doubt that the pyjama girl was the most famous corpse in Australian history. By the time the case was over, she'd been reconstructed, put on public display, and even made up with lipstick and rouge in the hope that someone might identify her. But if she was the most famous victim in Australian crime, perhaps she's also the most forgotten. Linda Agostini lies here in plot 8341 in Preston Cemetery in Melbourne. It cost the government hundreds of thousands of pounds to find out who she was. But when she was finally buried here, there was apparently not enough government money left to put her name on the grave. They say that crime doesn't pay, but it's not a bad way of making a name for yourself. More than half a century ago, an evil little punk terrorised these streets called the Narrows in Melbourne's Fitzroy. He was a pickpocket, standover man and blackmailer. He was implicated in more than half a dozen murders, but never convicted of any of them. In the long run, he never really did anything very much except get himself killed in a mysterious gun battle. But even after 50 years, he's still a legend here in Melbourne. His name was Squizzy Taylor.
I think one of the truest things that Taylor ever said was one time in his later life, he said, "I'm only a newspaper hero." And I think this is really one of the keys to Taylor. Because when you look at Taylor's life up until, say, 1920, 21, there's nothing really to distinguish him from a runabout larrikin crook of the times.
But Theodore Joseph Lester Taylor wasn't just a newspaper invention. By 1920, he'd already been involved in at least two murders and a string of robberies. The public called him Squizzy, and to his fellow criminals, he was the Turk. But whatever they called him, he was never a particularly pleasant customer. In those heady days, just after World War I, Melbourne revelled in its reputation as the wicked city of the Commonwealth. It was the crime capital of Australia, and Squizzy was its undisputed boss. The Taylor name was almost an automatic guarantee of violent crime. At Glenferrie Station, a bank manager was shot and killed during a robbery organised by Taylor. The chauffeur of this hire car was killed in cold blood after refusing to help Squizzy rob a bank messenger. And Taylor even used his own car to run down and kill the young daughter of a prosecution witness. But it was all still pretty small time. While the American mobsters were making millions, Squizzy fought a constant battle just to stay out of jail. He sported flash clothes and flash girlfriends, like the teenage shoplifter Ida Pender. But even at home in the company of the fairer sex, he wasn't immune from regular police raids.
I went to the back door, and instead of knocking at the back door, I just put the jimmy in and bang, and I dashed up the front, and there's Squizzy Taylor was in the bedroom with Ida Pender. So and I just put my gun to him and I said, "Jump out of the bed," and he said, "She can't get out, she's got nothing on." I said, "Well, she won't bloody well frighten me." So I said, "You can still jump out, you see." So anyhow...
So you got a glimpse of Ida Pender?
Well, I didn't. She was a good sort, too.
The raids on Squizzy's various homes never amounted to much. But in 1921, he was caught red-handed during a warehouse robbery. It was something of a turning point in his career. Skipping the £3,000 bail, he went into hiding for almost a year and led the police a merry chase around Melbourne. He surfaced occasionally to indulge his notorious vanity by writing to the newspapers. In one letter he wrote, "As soon as I've settled some business, I'll pop into the CIB where I'll be welcome." The sneering little braggart was making fools of the coppers, and the public loved every minute of it.
If you talk to people about Squizzy Taylor now, people will say to you, "Yes, my mother or my father said that he lived around the corner from us." Mm. And that may have been quite so, because he moved around pretty extensively, but largely from Caulfield out into other places. He was supposed to have been hiding in the back of one of the theatres in Melbourne. He was supposedly seen dressed as a schoolboy, going around, hopping on trams. He was even supposed to have gone to the races dressed up as a girl at the height of fashion, and he found that rather hard to take. He said whatever else he was not a poofter.
By the time he finally gave himself up to the police in 1922, Squizzy was front page news and well on the way to becoming a legend. Out on bail again, Squizzy was shot at the night before the trial, but turned up on crutches to hear the jury somehow find him not guilty. The cocky, reckless bully boy was at the peak of his career. And even with charges of murder and armed robbery hanging over his head, the spiv in Squizzy Taylor couldn't be suppressed. In defiance of warnings and the odd arrest, he continued to show up at the racetracks that had been his nursery in crime.
The stewards here at Caulfield Racecourse in Melbourne were well aware of his reputation as a tout, an urger, a pickpocket, and a general undesirable. So when they noticed him here in the crowd in 1922, they had no hesitation in having him chucked out into the street. But Squizzy was back the very same night to settle a few debts. He took a match and some fuel and burnt the member stand to the ground.
It was a pretty effective demonstration of his power, but there wouldn't be too many more examples of the Taylor arrogance. His luck was running out. On October 27th, 1927, at the age of 42, he came to this house in Barclay Street, Carlton. Waiting was an up-and-coming young standover man called Snowy Cutmore. In the five-minute gun battle which erupted that night, both men were killed. Today, Squizzy's grave is forgotten and overgrown, and rightly so. He was, after all, just a pimp and a pickpocket who graduated to extortion and murder. He was also a treacherous informer and sneak, a swaggering, conceited criminal fop who was terrified of physical violence to himself, but dished it out to others. It's strange material from which to fashion an Australian legend. July the 1st, 1960, and this man had good cause to be happy. Basil Thorne had just won the Opera House lottery, £100,000 for himself, his wife Frieda and their two children, Belinda, aged 3, and 8-year-old son, Graham. The joy in the Thorne's Bondi flat would last just 1 week.
Mr. and Mrs. Thorne were determined that their windfall would not disrupt Graham's school life. But he was obviously thrilled, and he once told a school teacher, "Do you know who I am? I'm Graham Thorne, the £100,000 boy." Every morning he'd leave for school as usual and walk down here in Wellington Street to the corner of O'Brien Street. When he got here, he usually stopped at the corner shop and bought himself a packet of potato chips. He'd eat them while he waited for the mother of two other Scots College boys to come and pick him up and take him to school. On July 7, 1960, he came here as usual. A 12-year-old friend, Peter Snedden, saw him as he was being driven past in a car. It was the last time Graham Thorne was seen alive.
For the first few hours, the police treated the disappearance as a routine lost child investigation. But Frieda Thorne was convinced it had something to do with the lottery win. Sergeant Lawrence O'Shea of Bondi Police arrived to take down a detailed description of Graham. And shortly after, the phone rang. Mrs. Thorne answered, and a foreign voice said bluntly, "I have your son."
She passed the phone over to O'Shea, and the caller said, "I have the boy. I want £25,000. If you don't pay the money, I'll feed him to the sharks." O'Shea replied, "Where would I get that type of money?" O'Shea, at that period, was unaware that the Thorns had won the £100,000 lottery. And then Bradley hung up.
The voice belonged to Stephen Leslie Bradley, a Hungarian who'd come to Australia in 1950. It was the first and last time he would contact Graham Thorne's parents.
8-year-old schoolboy Frederick Graham Thorne, victim of Australia's first case of kidnapping, whose parents have received a telephone demand for £25,000 ransom. A huge investigation with headquarters at Bondi Police Station swings into action. Notices are posted offering £15,000 reward for information leading to the boy's return and the apprehension of those responsible. A heartbroken father has this to say.
"When I got home, I was told that somebody had rang demanding a sum of money, which I'm not going to... Well, I don't know what it was. I'm saying you can imagine how upset I am and everything like that. But, and then... And then when you...
Is there any appeal you'd like to make to me?
Well, all I can say is that the person that's got him, if he's a father, he's got children of his own, well, for God's sake, send him back in one piece.
The search quickly moves to French's Forest with the discovery near this memorial of the missing boy's school case. The first major clue. Among these articles are Graham's school cap marked with his name and a maths book. An apple remains of the lunch Graham's mother prepared before he left home. Literally leaving no stone unturned, the police work on into the night. By now, it is one of the most intensified search operations in our history.
5 weeks after Graham Thorne disappeared, two small boys discovered his body jammed into a rock crevice in a small patch of scrub at Seaforth, a northern suburb about 10 miles from Bondi. The hopes for finding the boy alive were gone, but the chances of tracking down his murderer had increased dramatically. The body was wrapped in a travelling rug, and the police were sure that forensic examination of plant fragments collected from that rug would provide a lead. and in a small cottage tucked away in a quiet corner of Sydney's Botanic Gardens, a patient woman did supply the much-needed breakthrough.
We found that there were two plants which proved to be of significance that we knew as garden plants but were not bush plants, were not present at the site where Graham Thorne's body was found, and therefore must have been become attached to the rug and clothing somewhere else. Now, in the course of identification, one of my colleagues went out into the Botanic Gardens to collect fresh material of what he, at that stage, believed these plants to be, and brought in a twig about so big of each one of them. So that when Detective Sergeant Clark came to get our report, I showed him these two pieces of green material and said, well, they're practically all bush plants except for two of them, which are these. And he looked at them with intense interest. He said, can I keep these? And I said, of course you can.
Those two innocuous cypress cuttings were to help seal Bradley's fate. After weeks of laborious cross-checking, a postman led detectives to a house which had both the shrubs they'd been looking for on each side of the garage entrance. The house was in Clontarf, a suburb no more than a mile from where Graham Thorne's body was found. It was vacant, but the name of the previous tenant was Stephen Leslie Bradley. Bradley had already fled Australia on the liner Himalaya. The ship's photographer snapped him lurking in the background of a party in the wheelhouse. It was to be a short holiday. Convinced they now had a complete case, Australian police flew to Colombo and Ceylon. They boarded the Himalaya and arrested Bradley. The trial was conducted in a public atmosphere of outrage and total hatred. And when the jury handed down their inevitable verdict, 9 months of accumulated anger were finally released.
Oh, there was a tremendous reaction in the court. People stood up and shouted out and hurled abuse at Bradley. And it took the judge about 5 minutes to quieten him down, and he eventually cleared the court, and Bradley ultimately was sentenced to life imprisonment.
In October 1968, after a game of tennis with the prison governor, Stephen Leslie Bradley, kidnapper and murderer, suffered a heart attack and died. There were many who thought he should never have been allowed to live that long.
You must remember this, a kiss is still a kiss, a sigh is just a sigh, the fundamental things apply as time